Welcome to AI for Marketing and Sales. This is a 7-week masterclass sponsored by the mayor's office, Miami-Dade County Mayor's Office, and part of the Strive 305 initiative. We have two incredible partners, the agency Saltbox and the agency AI Smart Marketing, and they're going to be my co-hosts and co-instructors throughout this 7-week journey. Every Wednesday at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time, right here, same bat day, same bat channel, you'll get the master classes. And we're going to talk about today the human element of AI, and then we're going to dig in more deeply into other specific topics that we know you're excited to be part of. Please mark your calendars. We don't want you to miss anything. There's a lot of benefits to coming live, but we will also be sending you a recording if you can't make it. The link is going to always be the same, try.bizhack.com/AIZoom. So you can add that to your calendar and you'd always know where to show up. This is really important. A lot of folks often kind of aren't paying attention totally. They're multitasking, you're on your email. Just give me this 30 seconds of attention. These are kind of the way that we're going to function. And it'll really help you out a lot. Number one is, if you have a question you want to ask, click the Q&A. I'm going to be monitoring the questions live and answering as many of them as possible, either in the moment or via chat. So the questions go in the Q&A. Nicole and Brett are also going to be monitoring the Q&A and answering questions as they come in that they can handle. Our goal is to get through as many of your questions as possible live. Second is, we're going to ask you to give us prompts. We're going to prompt you for information, and that information goes in the chat. Additionally, if you have stuff you want to share with us, that also goes in the chat. So if you want to share with us an article or a book, please put it there. One request is no solicitation. This is a no sales zone, even though we're talking about marketing and sales. So there's 7 things that you can expect from us as part of this experience. Number one, during the live sessions, they're going to be structured a little bit like a course. And what does that mean? You're going to see when we go into it that there's going to be learning objectives. The curriculum is what we call laddered, which means each class builds on the prior one. So a lot of the context and framework and definitions that we're going to give today are going to help you understand what comes in class 2, masterclass 3, and so forth. And there will be homework. We just won't be grading it, and you won't be getting a grade at the end of the semester. There's a live chat where we'll share resources. We'll give you resources, and you'll share resources with us. References, tools, and case studies. The poll, we're going to ask you to share your experience. The Q&A, we'll do it live. All of our experts will try to tackle as many of your questions as possible. You can expect an email on Monday with a recap of each of that week's sessions with key takeaways and resources. We'll also send you reminders about these sessions so you attend live. And then finally, our goal is to do bonus inspiration. We're going to have a potential, if there are enough questions, a bonus Ask Me Anything session that'll happen later. We also, at every session, we're going to be doing some extra work all the way up until 2 p.m. Eastern time. So the goal is for these sessions, the formal curriculum to last about an hour, so 1:30, 1:45 Eastern. And then we're going to use the remaining time up until 2 to just take your marketing to the next level, workshop things, have fun. So that's what you can expect from us. We have 7 things that we'd like to expect from you. Number one is come to these live sessions. Number two is be active in the chat. Number three is ask lots of questions in the Q&A. Number four is try to do the homework. Number five is spread the word. This is a free service sponsored by Miami-Dade County. Many thousands of dollars invested in this, and we would love to share this with as many people as possible. Number six, connect with us on LinkedIn. Number seven, follow us on social media. We'll follow you back. As we've mentioned, the sponsorship was with Miami-Dade County and the Strive 305 initiative. Our partners include South Florida PBS and these amazing community partners. And then the instructors are myself, Nicole Donnelly of AI Smart Marketing. You'll meet her very shortly. And Jeff Cooper of Saltbox. I believe he's actually in Disney today, so he's not going to make it, but we've asked Jeff, his digital avatar, to join us. We do also have special guests, including today's special guest, Brett Spodak, who you'll be hearing from in a little bit. So with that, we're going to get started with Unit 1. Welcome to Unit 1, the human element of artificial intelligence. My name is Dan Grech, and with Nicole Donnelly and the avatar of Jeff Cooper, we are the lead instructors of AI for marketing and sales. There are five core objectives. Number one is we want to give you the context. We want you to understand what is artificial intelligence, who are the big businesses that are behind it, and what is the information you need to understand the tools and the skills that are required. The skills are really about if you're someone who's actually doing the marketing, creating marketing or sales content, the emails, the landing pages, the webinars, what are the things, the skills as a human being that you need to have in order to be able to do it effectively? And then the tools are, what are the software tools that you can use to help you? The challenges are many. Hallucination, intellectual property, bias, and legal and ethical considerations. We're going to continuously talk about those. Those are always risks to your use of this. And finally, the inspiration. We want to inspire you with incredible case studies and incredible examples of what we call the AI moment, that moment when you realize that this is a life-changing and an epoch-changing technology. Who is this course for? Well, it's for really two people. It's for the business leader and the marketing doer. And I asked one of the great AI image generation programs, DALL-E, to create an image of a cartoon image of a business leader and a cartoon image of a marketing doer, a marketing coordinator. This is literally what happened. DALL-E came back with that Frankenstein looking thing. And then it told me its server was overloaded, so it couldn't create an image of the marketing coordinator. Part of the point here is we are in the early stages of mass adoption of these AI tools. They're clunky, they're kludgy, they're overwhelmed. And so I kind of like the fact that the marketing director is going to have to wait to a later session. A lot of times I find that I'm trying to use a ChatGPT and it's just overloaded. So there are seven units. Today is the human element of artificial intelligence. The next three sessions, we're going to talk about text, images, and then video and audio. Those are really about the doer. That's about how do you make marketing and sales content that's going to be better and faster. And then we're going to raise it up a level. And we're going to talk about content strategy. We're going to talk about sales and sales enablement. And we're going to talk about analytics and prediction. And those are really things that the business owner and the business leader needs to be thinking about. So there's the doing. And that's the fun part. We're going to have a lot of fun over these next four sessions. And then there's the strategy and how these same tools can build creative strategies and just be just as effective if you're in that top seat in a company. Today, Unit 1, the human element of artificial intelligence, we're going to talk about the basic definitions and historical context and its world-changing potential. We're going to recognize the significant challenges posed by AI around accuracy, bias, and security. And we're going to get you inspired by concrete examples and expert tips about how to use AI in your marketing and sales today. Buckle up. So we're going to start by inviting you to jump into the chat. And we're going to give you the very first live prompt of our time together. So I want to just quickly define what I mean by a live prompt. And all it is something to get you thinking about AI in your business that you can put in the chat. And every class, we're going to have a live prompt at the beginning of the session. And then we're going to work together. We're going to workshop your live prompt, brainstorm in real time at the end of the session during the bonus. So here is the live prompt. What's something you recently wrote or designed related to marketing or sales where you did not use AI? So this could be, for instance.
Chat is disabled for everybody listening in. And so the only place they can type in is in the Q&A.
Okay.
Can we get chat enabled for them?
Yes, John, is that something you can take care of, please?
Yeah, let me check.
So for now, if you can't use the chat for the folks on the session, we'll use the Q&A for the prompt as well. Thank you for that, Nicole.
Yeah, thanks.
So what I'd like you all to do is I'd like you to talk about something in the Q&A that you did recently, something that you wrote or designed that's related to marketing or sales where you did not use AI. This could be writing an email newsletter or a blog or a social media post, creating a video ad, designing a flyer. And you should include just a very concise description of the relevant details of what you were promoting, who you were targeting, and how much time and money you spent on it. So here's an example. I spent 10 hours translating from English to Spanish the transcript of a 2-hour long digital marketing class for business owners. Simple. So please tell us something you did recently that you wrote or designed related to marketing or sales where you didn't use AI. Nicole is going to be working behind the scenes to try to pick a few of those and make some progress against those prompts that we can then share with you and workshop with you during the bonus session. Now, this is an example of prompt engineering, and we're going to talk a lot more about what is a prompt in the context of AI and how to engineer a prompt during Unit 2. Next, I wanted to share something that I call the AI moment. And this is the moment that many of us have experienced when you realize that there is a before and an after in your life, before AI and after AI. I remember I was a kid in third grade when the Challenger blew up, and I was a junior reporter at the Miami Herald when the Twin Towers collapsed. And to me, the AI moment is that indelible moment when you just realize when you're playing with one of these tools that this is completely different than anything you've ever seen in your life. And what's really cool is I'm not making this thing up about the AI moment. Bill Gates wrote a 7-part essay on his blog about this fact, about this AI moment that he had. He said, quote, AI is the most important advance in technology since the graphical user interface. At the same time as people are having these almost spiritual moments with AI, the alarm bells are ringing, and they're ringing loud. Stephen Hawking, the physicist, wrote, "The development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race." Alan Perlis, an AI pioneer, said, "A year spent in artificial intelligence is enough to make one believe in God." Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla and SpaceX, said, "With artificial intelligence, we're summoning the demon." So which is it? Is it God or the demon? Is it the incredible human potential, or is it the risk to the end of the human race? So that's the context. That is the debate that is happening, raging right now. You know, there have been open letters from technologists begging companies to slow down while Google and Microsoft and Facebook are in an all-out war for supremacy in this space, heedlessly sometimes pushing stuff out that could cause a ton of damage. And so what we want to try to do with you during this 7 units is we really want to try to help you navigate this very complicated space. And what we hope is that you'll come away from this smarter and maybe a little bit more sober about what is possible and what's not. So I wanted to take a second and share with you a video from 60 Minutes that to me says an incredible amount about It's basically seeing in a 60 Minutes correspondent having a AI moment in real time. Here it is.
For sale, baby shoes never worn.
Wow.
The only prompt we gave was finish this story.
So just a little bit of context. Ernest Hemingway wrote a very famous six-word story called For Sale, Baby Shoes Never Used. And so he's now asking, this is Google Bard, to finish that six-word story that Ernest Hemingway wrote.
In 5 seconds. Holy cow. The shoes were a gift from my wife, but we never had a baby. They were from the six-word prompt, Bard created a deeply human tale with characters it invented, including a man whose wife could not conceive and a stranger grieving after a miscarriage and longing for closure.
I am rarely speechless. I don't know what to make of this. Give me...
We asked for the story in verse. In 5 seconds, there was a poem written by a machine with breathtaking insight into the mystery of faith. Bard wrote, "She knew her baby's soul would always be alive." The humanity, at superhuman speed, was a shock.
How is this possible?
How is this possible? That is the AI moment that many of us have had. How is this possible? I'd like for you guys, if you haven't yet, is our chat working, by the way, now? Yes, great. I'd like for you guys to share, those of you who have had one, an AI moment. And while you do that, I want to share my own. So go ahead in the chat, share your AI moment. We'd love to hear your personal, emotional, human experience of AI. Mine was really interesting. It was a couple months ago. It was late at night. My kids were in bed and I was on my phone in bed, propped up on my pillows. And I had been just reading all this stuff about ChatGPT. This wasn't, you know, it was released on November 30th, ChatGPT 3.5, but this was like 2 months later. And I'd been reading and reading and reading New York Times and all these articles and all this hullabaloo and Google loses $100 billion and Google Bard and the arms race. And I hadn't actually played with the tool. So I went, I Googled it, ChatGPT, I found it. It's like a little chat bot. You'll definitely see a lot of it during the session. And you just kind of type in the chat, not that different than what you're doing in the webinar chat. And then it gives you responses. And, you know, I started playing with it. I had seen this New York Times article about how it tried to break up the marriage of one of the columnists there, one of the tech columnists. And so I knew that there was a lot of fun ways to play with it, but I was actually kind of curious to see, to take it seriously as kind of a thought partner. So I started to tell it about a book I'm writing. And I was kind of giving a summary of what I was up to. And then I actually asked it about this one part of the book that I'm really struggling with. So as many of you know, I've built a methodology called the lead building system, and it's a lead building, and the building has the foundation and the pillars. But it occurred to me, you know, a building needs a roof, it needs walls, it needs windows. So I started like, and I've been doing this for 7 years and I had never like really figured this out. So I asked ChatGPT, hey, if this is the lead building, right? What are the walls? What is the ceiling? What are the windows? And it came back with these answers that were right. It was like, oh, well, the ceiling is your brand and the walls are your channels. And I'm like, oh my God. Like I had never thought about this. And like 7 years of deep thought, obsession, 26 cohorts of a course, an online version of the course. I have 45,000 words written for this book. And ChatGPT in 20 minutes was giving me insights that I had never come to by myself. That was my AI moment. And it made me realize, I mean, I'm having goosebumps even thinking about it. Like there is a before and an after in my life and in our lives. Like we are living through a building of a tool as profound and as an epochal as the internet. Full stop, period. And so we're going to talk about this, but you have a choice, which is either learn AI or get left behind. And what's so beautiful about the tool is a lot of those tools, at least for now, are free. And so it's not about money. It's more about knowledge. And that's what this course is about. It's about giving you the knowledge that you need to be relevant in this space. So I wanted to give you a brief history of AI. And I'll be honest, I asked ChatGPT to help with this, and this is a kind of a summary of their responses. Let me just stop sharing. Do you see the black bar at the top? Or is it, it is? Okay, let me. Let me try that again. Sorry about that. Thanks for your patience. Okay, let me start over. So let me give you a brief history of artificial intelligence. And I got to admit that this was how I used ChatGPT to help me with this, and I kind of condensed what they gave me. The history of artificial intelligence really dates back to a pioneering computer scientist, one of the people who built the first computer. His name was Alan Turing. He was really important during World War II. And he proposed this idea called the Turing test. And he said that when a machine can exhibit intelligent behavior equivalent to or indistinguishable from that of a human, that is the definition of artificial intelligence. And there was this test where essentially a chatbot was set up and the responses were either human generated or computer generated, and people were asked, can you tell if that's a human or a robot? So that's the Turing test. It's like the intellectual framework and a way to define what artificial intelligence means. The term artificial intelligence didn't come actually until 6 years later at a gathering of intellectuals called the Dartmouth Conference. By the way, a lot of the heroes of AI are nerdy researchers. And you're gonna actually meet kind of our resident nerd, Jeff Cooper, coming up soon. He's really the kind of guy who gets into the nuts and bolts of it. And those are the guys who are, many of these are PhDs and researchers employed by Google, employed by Facebook, employed by Stanford, who are building these tools. In 2011, IBM Watson defeats two human champions on Jeopardy. In 2016, AlphaGo, which was developed by Google, defeats the world champion at the board game Go, one of the most complex board games in the world. And then in 2022, ChatGPT 3.5 is released and all hell breaks loose. That was in November. And I wanted to give my partner, Nicole, a chance to talk about kind of the modern history of AI and then how it led up to this moment.
Thank you. A lot of people know what Grammarly is. It checks your spelling, and now it even will give you suggestions of different sentences, how you could rewrite something. And Grammarly has been learning since 2009. It's been learning the words people commonly mistype. It's been learning sentence structure. It's been learning, if you've been subscribed for a very long time, to what your voice is like when you're writing. And a lot of organizations that I work with have Grammarly for all their employees so they can just write better emails even. And then 2015, Monkey Learn came around, and Monkey Learn was a plugin that could take in information and parse it out to what is valuable for you. And it would learn more and more based on feedback, and you would have to give it a lot of feedback. So if I have a list, I had a list of press queries that came from Haro, help a reporter out. You could feed it into Monkey Learn and tell Monkey Learn to only give you the press queries that had certain keywords in it, and then it would do that. But it was a pretty manual and clunky process, which we have an evolution for that one currently that's much more sophisticated. In 2019, we started using Otter, and Otter and Firefly and some of the others now, they will follow you around on all your Zoom meetings and take notes for you. Otter today does screenshots and you can summarize your notes, but you can, so we used it for podcast transcripts and show notes, and then we'd put that to a blog post. And that saved us a lot of time in processing transcripts. In 2020, chatbots started taking over. So when you go to a website, you often encounter a chatbot for your first interaction with someone's customer service. And if anybody's ever popped up a chatbot, you know, you had to program what the answers could possibly be for all of the questions that someone could come and have. And now it's super smart. You can integrate ChatGPT and you can have it learn what the questions are if you have a big database of them, and smartly produce much better prompts, and you don't have to program it all. It just learns from your information. In 2021, we started using this AI for emotionality. Emotionality is a program where you go in, you take a quiz, you learn what your top emotional need is. And you can subscribe to a text message service and emails, and you'll start to get text messages that support you and your emotional needs. And on the back end, the AI is learning what kind of content you like to interact with. If you like videos or images, if you like memes, or if you like more of the text or text long lessons. And it'll serve up more of that information. So it's learning you and giving your preferences back to you. Jasper AI was called Jarvis. It came out in 2021. And I'd say for me, that was kind of my AI aha. Because Jasper started saving us time every day in writing the content that we have to write. As a marketing agency, you have to write so much content. You have to write the website content. And as everybody has been posting in here, most people's pain comes in writing content and designing brochures. It looks like everybody's having a hard time, or, you know, spending time on website content. Well, Jasper has all these different templates and you can go in and use them and get a lot of good content really quickly. So I'd say it doubled our output in the first month and probably quadrupled our output within about 3 months, like 4 to 5 times our output. And then in Gmail started giving email prompts. So when you're writing your emails in Gmail, it finishes your sentences for you, because it's been learning this whole time too, since they started implementing their AI on the background. And so now it knows how you write and the things that you might say next. And I personally love that it, you know, it just makes the email writing faster. And then Jasper also plugs into Gmail. So if I wanted to, Jasper will continue it even farther than Gmail will. And I can write emails using Jasper. There's a little poll that just popped up. So let us know if you've used an AI tool and how many times you've used ChatGPT in the past week. And also which you've used at least once in a list of tools, and if you have found that you've saved money using AI tools. For us, it's about saving time and making more money. And then in 2022, we started using Robotic Marketer, which does marketing strategies. And, you know, there's page after page of input. It took us from 8 weeks to create a marketing strategy before Robotic Marketer down to about 2 weeks now. And so it saved us a ton of time. Again, it didn't necessarily make us money on that one, but it did save us time and money. And Canva, which a lot of people use for graphics, has AI apps in there, and you can ask it to make images specifically for you. And it's kind of fun. It's not perfect, but it's fun to play with. Midjourney does amazing photorealistic images now. And then, of course, ChatGPT came along and made it really easy for everybody to use AI. And now in 2023, there are new AI tools coming out every single day. There's a website called There's an AI for That, and they've got probably a couple thousand listed at least on the website. And so you can search by category on what kind of processes you're trying to shortcut with AI. And there is probably an AI for that. And if not, I can guarantee you somebody's working on it, and probably several people are. So I think it's a time where, like, I want to keep things simple and accessible so that everybody in here can learn how to use AI and you don't feel overwhelmed by it. And it's something that will be able to save you time every day if you just keep your little tab open with AI and start to use it on a regular basis. Can we go to the next?
Yeah, great job. Yeah, so what we're really seeing, and thank you very much, Nicole, we'll be hearing from you in a sec again, is what we're really seeing is the technology adoption curve. We just jumped the chasm. I really mark November 30th when ChatGPT was released as the moment when we came to the other side of the chasm from early adopters like Nicole, who's been doing this for 8 years, to regular Joes like me who are sitting in my bed playing with ChatGPT. ChatGPT was just this very accessible kind of eye-popping tool that a lot of us have been using. So looking right now at the poll, about 2/3 of you have participated. I would invite those of you who haven't participated to jump in. We're gonna close it here in a second. But about 1 in 4 of you have never used ChatGPT. That's actually pretty good. Across the adult US population, approximately 50% of adults in the US have used ChatGPT in the previous week. Now, on one hand, that's like only 50. On the other hand, it's a tool that's only been around for a couple of months. It is the fastest adoption of a new technology in the history of mankind. The second fastest adoption was Instagram. And what they were able to accomplish in 4 months, it took Instagram 4 years. So this is literally orders of magnitude faster adoption than anything we've ever seen ever. Faster than the internet, faster than Facebook, faster than Instagram, faster than anything. And it is a product of the ease of the tool. And it also explains why it kind of flares out and sometimes gets overburdened, because just not only are more people using it, but they're using it more often. So the volume of usage is giant. Now, what is the implication of that? Developed countries, people with money and resources, they're gonna have more advantages with AI because of the massive computing power required to run it. And so there's an inherent bias that we'll be talking about in the fact that only really wealthy companies, countries, and people have access to these tools. We happen to live in the richest country in the world, and so we do have access to these tools. But even for us, unless you pay, you get throttled sometimes. So I want to talk now about a philosophy that we have during this course about AI as a partner. And actually, before I get to that, I wanted to just share the results. 2/3 of you participated. Thank you for that. About 50% of you have used it for both business and personal use. Only 16% of you are not sure what AI is. 1/4 of you have not used ChatGPT. An equal number of you are using it 5 or more times a week. A lot of you, when you actually see the AI tools that you use, have used many of them. Only about 12% of you have never used an AI tool. But by and large, the tools that you're using are either voice assistants or text. We're going to go into image, video, and search, and you're going to see the incredible possibilities for that. And many, many of you have saved hundreds of dollars by using these AI tools. about 20% of you have saved either hundreds or thousands of dollars. I'm in the thousands camp. Nicole, how much money would you say you've either made or saved? Just kind of ballpark. It's probably in the tens or hundreds of thousands.
I was gonna say it's at least tens of thousands for sure.
Yeah, that's what an early, so she's lucky. She's been on this bandwagon longer than us. So that's what her results have been. So let's talk about AI as a partner. And this is kind of the philosophy of this course. You know, we heard earlier about the kind of doomsday scenarios the Elon Musks of the world are saying. And there is real truth and there are real risks to this technology. But what I wanted to share with you is a story from the history of AI that talks about really how we are framing AI and how we recommend you think about it as well. So I don't know if you remember, but you know, we talked about in the history of AI, you know, beating Jeopardy champions and beating people at Go. Well, there was another seminal moment, which was beating Garry Kasparov in chess. And I don't know if you remember this, but at one point, Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov, the greatest grand champion in the history of chess. And there were headlines bemoaning the end of human intelligence and gnashing of teeth. But there's a part of this story that Walter Isaacson talks about in his book, The Innovators, that is rarely told, which is what happened next. So they then organized another tournament. And in this tournament, Garry Kasparov and Deep Blue participated as individual participants. But there were computer scientists who also loved chess who played as well. And there was one set of computer scientists who were decent chess players, not grandmasters by any stretch, but who really knew how to engineer prompts and how to interpret data from AI. They leveraged three different artificial intelligence programs and they ended up winning the tournament, beating both the greatest grandmaster in history, Garry Kasparov, and the greatest artificial intelligence model to date, Deep Blue. And the lesson here is very simple. It's not AI versus human. It's AI plus human versus humans alone. We are dedicated to helping you learn how to be AI, human plus AI. Because human plus AI is future ready. And human without AI is going to get left behind. With where AI is today, and I'm making no predictions about where it's headed, but with where AI is today, it is an imperfect tool. It's like a really smart grad student who you have as a research assistant, or a really creative thinker who always comes out with cool out-of-the-box ideas. It's up to you to know what to ask them and then how to interpret what they share with you so that you can make the most of it for your business. So what we're going to do is really focus on the AI plus human partnership and get you the most out of it. Let me give you an example that I bet most of you aren't aware of about what this partnership can look like and how cool it can be. So a lot of people think about ChatGPT and all the fancy cutting edge software that folks like Nicole have been working with for years. But did you know that there is AI built into Microsoft's tools like PowerPoint? If you go into the slideshow menu right now and you look, there's something called Rehearse with Coach. And Rehearse with Coach is an artificial intelligence program that allows you to practice your speech, and then it will evaluate on pacing, pitch, use of filler words, informal speech, euphemisms, culturally sensitive terms. It'll detect if you're going too fast or you're being too wordy or you're reading the text like I am right now. It would penalize me. It says you're reading the text. And then after each rehearsal, you get a report with statistics. And this is actual screenshots from what that would look like. And what's really crazy and really cool is sensitive phrases. If you use the term best man for the job, it'll tell you might be culturally insensitive in some areas. So it is really doing an incredible job of providing an artificial intelligence like a coach for your work. And this is built in to a tool that almost all of us have used and use regularly. That's what we mean by AI as a partner. So next, I wanted to talk to you about the AI wars. And this is going to come up a lot when we talk about search and how search is being changed and Google is being impacted by all of this. And I'm going to give you a very kind of high level overview of what this means. And then we will be bringing this back up all the time. So first thing you need to understand is that every major company, from Apple to Google to Microsoft to hundreds of startups to all of these engineers that left the Apples and the Googles to start their own companies, all the PhDs from Stanford that left to start with their own companies, there is just an explosion of AI creativity and companies. And the one that caused us to jump the chasm, ChatGPT, is built by a company called OpenAI. Now, OpenAI is started out as a nonprofit. A lot of the Google engineers were part of it. They started to work with large language models and some of the cutting edge of artificial intelligence. And then they released ChatGPT online in November, and all heck broke loose. ChatGPT's main funder is Microsoft, who's put $13 billion into it and is now building ChatGPT into its basically formerly non-entity search engine, Bing. And suddenly Bing, which has, I think, like under 5% of the search market, is now becoming a significant competitor to Google search. Now, Google, ironically, is the company that pioneered many of the ideas that are now being used in artificial intelligence research. But because a lot of it is research, it's academic and it's published and it's then shared with the community. And so Google, a couple of weeks after ChatGPT was released in November, they released a version of their ChatGPT, and it was immediately panned by critics, and the company lost $100 billion in market cap overnight. So they pulled it. And in the last week, they put Bard back out for public display. Google is going to be a major player in this space, but they have to be really careful, because unlike OpenAI, which is a startup, they have a $200 billion ad business to protect. And they're really worried about how generative search, where you create new content, is going to compete with, where generative AI is going to compete with traditional search. Because in many ways, you get better answers from generative AI and ChatGPT than what you get from Google. So Microsoft versus Google, Meta is very active in this space. Everybody is throwing their hat in the ring. All of the traditional players, you know, the Slacks and the HubSpots, they're now building AI into their programs, and the game is on. The war is on. The battles are being waged. There's a lot of noise about this. You know, you'll be hearing a lot about this every day for the rest of your lives. And we are now in the middle of the rapid arms race to get as much out and to gobble up as much market and mind share as possible. We're going to try to help you navigate all this noise. Honestly, most of it is noise. You know, Google right now is not leading. Microsoft is, but don't count Google out. They have some of the best engineers working on these problems in the world. They're just taking it a little bit slow. You will see, I promise. So without further ado, let's do some quick introductions. First, I wanted to introduce myself. I'm Dan. I'm part of BizHack, and we use AI-powered tools to offer part-time head of marketing into businesses. I spent 15 years in journalism at NPR, PBS, The Washington Post. I was a podcast pioneer created Under the Sun. I've headed marketing for billion-dollar companies and software startups. I'm a proud member of EO South Florida, proud alumni of Goldman Sachs 10KSB, as well as of Princeton, and got my master's degree at Florida International University. I wanted to share with you a little bit more about my background. My grandfathers are great inspirations to me. On the left, you'll see Grandpa Satur from Spain, my father's father. He was a coach in La Liga. And on the right, you'll see Henry Marcus from Philadelphia. He was a physics teacher at the second oldest public high school in the country, Central High School. And this legacy of coaching and teaching just runs through the generations and straight into me. And I'm so motivated to help coach and teach. And a lot of that was taught to me by my mother, Elaine Grech, who was an art teacher in inner city Philadelphia for 35 years. Yes, exactly like Abbott Elementary, teaching an underdog subject to underdog students. And my whole career, I've really tried to be a champion of the underdog so that you, the business owner, the small, the underdog in the economy can transform your lives. And so the company that I founded, BizHack Academy, is all about providing businesses a simpler way to grow so you and your business can thrive. Not oversimplified, simpler. There's a lot of complexity in the world. We try to cut through the noise and give you just what you need to know to grow. Now, one of our partners is Jeff, and Jeff is with Saltbox, a search engine marketing firm specializing in paid and organic. And he is kind of a resident tech geek. He uses deep learning models and AI technologies for its clients. He's kind of our like resident white guy. You know, more than three quarters of the technologists who work in AI are white men. So we wanted to make sure that they were represented, and that's Jeff. He has a decade of experience in data, software development, search engine optimization, and online advertising. And you know, Jeff, you know, is kind of a nerdy, dorky guy. You know, he likes wearing hoodies. He has some acne in his 30s. But what we've used is Midjourney to help puff him up a little bit, because this is Jeff on AI, and the man is unstoppable. And Jeff actually wanted to share a quick story, a quick message with us. Can you hear me? Can you hear it? Real life human being. So let's see if we can hear it. Can you hear it? Okay, Nicole.
I originally thought it's pretty quiet.
Okay. So I'll play it just really quickly, and then we will I'll skip playing it, but it's basically this video, which I'll mute now. That's not Jeff, of course, but he created this video in under 5 minutes. And he used some really cool software to do it. You can see when you listen to it that the words and the mouth are not quite perfectly synced, but they're impressively so. He basically loaded a script and it created this video in minutes. So we're going to show you how to use that tool. We'll share a link to this video so you can learn from Avatar Jeff and hear from Avatar Jeff. And now, without further ado, I want to introduce the amazing Nicole Donnelly. So she'll introduce herself.
Okay. I am a serial entrepreneur. I've had product and service businesses. I've had two consumer product businesses. The first one we were selling into 85 countries and throughout all Target stores and Nordstrom. So I'm very familiar with consumer products. I've had a marketing agency for 13 years. And because that was kind of my favorite part of the business, I really like where brands emotionally connect with the customers. And I'm a very customer experience focused marketer. And let's see, what else? I don't know. I used to be a professional snowboarder. So, and I'm a lifelong athlete. I've done a lot of triathlons, ultramarathons, all that fun stuff. And I have an 18-year-old who's living in Costa Rica right now, living at an animal rescue, taking care of little babies. So in our household, we have these spectrums. My husband's an iOS developer and my child is with animals living in the jungle and has no desire to do anything with AI. And in our household, it's like all we talk about and all we do every day, which is a lovely dichotomy because it's keeps me grounded with, you know, probably a good half the world is going to be that way. And so you know, there's plenty of room for both sides in the future. And we need both kinds of people.
Absolutely. So Nicole, just really quick, what was your single biggest productivity win that you've achieved through using AI for marketing?
I mean, for us, it's writing. It's writing blog posts, it's writing web copy, all the writing that we do. We have saved so much time. That's where we've saved tens of thousands of dollars for sure. And, you know, if not more over the last couple of years, because projects that would take 8 weeks are down to 2 weeks. And so we can quadruple our output at using the same team.
And you run an AI-powered marketing agency. You've been really a pioneer, honestly, in providing AI-powered services. How do you use AI with your clients?
We do AI-assisted marketing strategies, and the marketing strategies, AI helps us do research, competitor analysis, SEO analysis on the website. It does a lot of the research that we would manually have to do before. And then after the research is done, then we have our source of truth, which I'll talk about in a bit, but we have our source of truth of information that we're going to share with our customers and send them on the path of, here's all of the things that you need to create for your website and for your brand. We still spend, I'd say, quite a bit of time on the soft side of branding. We can save time with images, but we do a lot of the copywriting for blogs. Rough drafts are always done in Jasper or ChatGPT.
Love it. And we're going to get so much of Nicole. You're going to get 6 more sessions with her, you know, borrowing her best practices, sharing her secrets. So happy to have you part of this. And so blessed. You know, this is a space where we see more men than women, and it's really great to have you as a co-pilot for this. Thank you so much for all that you've done to make today and all the sessions great.
Thank you.
So we're going to now talk about 5 definitions that we believe every business owner needs to understand and know in order to be able to really be conversant in AI for their business and AI for business, for marketing and sales. And those 5 terms are AI, what is it? Artificial intelligence, ChatGPT, source of truth, prompt, and hallucination. So I'm going to hand it over to Nicole.
Okay. Well, AI is also known as machine learning. And it's where a computer or a machine can perform a task, and these could be robots or these could be virtual tasks that typically would require a human to do. And it can be some problem solving. A lot of it for us at this point, the AI gets us 80% of the way there. We still need to bring it the rest of the way. So I would say even like problem solving, decision making, like this says, it's not 100% reliable, which I'll go into that a little bit more, but artificial intelligence really aids us in thinking about things and solving problems right now. And ChatGPT is a tool. It is the one that really broke AI out to the public. It's very easy to use. It doesn't take too much time to learn how to use GPT. And it says generative pre-trained transformer, which means they have trained it on the internet up to 2021. So you're not going to get new information unless you put it in yourself. So somebody asked a question about legislation and new policies, things like that. If you had all the new legislation that was passed in a year, you could upload that into ChatGPT and ask it for things that were relevant to whatever your business or industry is. And you could actually make it searchable. So somebody's done that with tax code and had input all of the latest tax code, and they have a phone number that you can call and ask it questions. And it's all AI generated. So while ChatGPT has the base of 2021, it's getting new information as people use it for these other things. So you can input it with your information and then make your information pop up when you're trying to get things like blog posts or copy for your website. Source of truth is so, so important. Knowing and having a discernment for what you're putting in and what you're reviewing when you get out. For me, the source of truth thing that comes up over and over is keywords on websites, and what people are going to write blog posts about. And what you think people are looking for on your site might not actually be true. And we use SEO tools and we go to the internet and search and find out what people are actually talking about to get them to your website so that your website can answer the questions. And it's still at this point a human, because if I ask ChatGPT to write articles based on my website, it's not going to give me the right information because it doesn't have the aggregated SEO knowledge yet. And so a human source of truth is important. It's also like driving a Tesla or any of those automated cars. There's a picture coming up, but you still need the driver. You still need someone there just in case. Prompt, and you'll hear prompt a lot. You're going to hear prompt and prompt engineering. And prompt is the words that you write or the words that you speak into the AI tool to get the results that you want, whether it's visual or verbal. It's that command that you give it. And prompting is an art. And, you know, we're getting better using it every day. We get better and better with it. And also prompts, some that work one week don't work the next. And don't work in the same way the next week. So this is a really rapidly evolving place. And that's the thing that you have to get good at, is asking the right questions. Hallucination is, I mean, we all know what hallucination is as a word in general, but hallucination applied to AI is when it gives information that is inaccurate. So I asked AI to rewrite my bio, you know, saying that I'm an AI expert, and it wrote my bio as if I was a comp sci grad from Stanford. And I can tell you, I did not go to Stanford. I went to Weber State University in Utah and I studied history, German, and photography. Like, I did not study computer science. This is something that I fell into, but ChatGPT was hallucinating and said that I went to Stanford.
So that actually is a perfect segment way into the five challenges that we wanted to highlight, the risks that we wanted to highlight that every business owner must understand and mitigate in their use of ChatGPT. There's hallucination, data security issues, bias, copyright, and ethics. And so I'll give it back to Nicole, has an incredible story about hallucination.
Yeah, so I was pulling up to an Airbnb, and if you look at the picture, you can see it shows that there's a semi in front of my car. And so, you know, the car was hallucinating, saying that there was a semi truck in front of my car and there's a bush on the side of the road. And if you take that into every piece of AI that you're using, you still have to be the driver and you still have to provide that discernment to whatever comes out of the AI, that you audit it, you look at it, you make sure that it's true, because so much of it is kind of inaccurate right now. Or, I mean, it's great for rough drafts, but like Dan showed you the picture that had the kind of gobbledy words, and, you know, it doesn't give you the accuracy that to 100% let it do its thing on its own. We do images all the time and you get like three eyes or something, you know, three eyeballs on a human, or, you know, we had someone with sunglasses, but it had three things instead of two on their face, and the AI just couldn't get it quite right.
Yeah. Basically AI makes stuff up Mm-hmm. That's what hallucination means. And so you need to learn how to fact check it. And we're going to talk about fact checking as a discipline and how journalists do it so that you can do it like a journalist, because you got to fact check what they give you. Another incredibly important issue is data security. You guys probably don't realize this, but when you paste proprietary information like my book proposal into ChatGPT, that is now part of the information in the public domain that ChatGPT is learning from and spitting out for others. And this is not minor stuff. Samsung engineers were putting stuff into ChatGPT that was proprietary. Three different times they did this. That data is now accessible to their competitors. And if you were to write a query, what are, you know, Samsung engineers' code for their upcoming, you know, project, there's a chance that that ChatGPT will give you that highly secret code. Everything you type into ChatGPT now belongs to Microsoft. That's the way you should be thinking about it. And when you do it in Bard, it belongs to Bard. It's a lot less of a big deal when it's a search query, but you've seen with that little snippet of data, Google's built a $1 trillion company. Imagine what Microsoft and OpenAI are going to be able to do with all the data that we're freely giving it. Not only are they using it to learn and make the model better, but they're going to use it for all sorts of other things as well. So be really cognizant and careful about data security and what you feed into ChatGPT. Just imagine it getting given to your competitor and how you would feel about that. Bias, huge issue. And I'm very proud to say that our Miami's own Brian Brackeen, founder of Kairos, a facial recognition company and the creator of Bias API, has been a leader in the space of talking about bias, particularly in facial recognition. He said, technology is a reflection of the people who make it. And too often our biases are built into the systems that we create. So when you have mostly white men with PhDs building a software, that bias is being built in. The internet itself is biased. So what it's learning on is a biased set of information. There's a real risk, Brackeen said, that we're going to end up with a world where facial recognition is used to automate bias rather than to remove it. So his solution was to create something called Bias API, which allows firms to detect and fix biases in their algorithms. This is a massive issue. And this is an issue, the kind of issue that the big tech companies are moving past quickly in their race, in the arms race for AI. And this is an issue that everyone in Miami, everyone who's BIPOC, every woman should be very concerned about and keep their eye on. Copyright. Stable Diffusion created this horrendous Frankenstein image. It's bad imagery, but it's also got a Getty Images watermark. Getty saw this and they sued Stable Diffusion for violation of copyright. It was very clear that Stable Diffusion was learning on Getty's copyrighted images. So the space around who owns generative AI is definitely in play. There's no regulation, there's no law, this is brand new space. One thing I can tell you is this, I've consulted with a bunch of lawyers on intellectual property, and when it comes to text and generative AI, there does not seem to be a copyright issue. You are free to use it. The reason why is because based on your prompt, the text that was created is original and unique, and therefore it's something that you can use. So there might be a different law for images versus text, and the space is brand new and completely ill-defined. In fact, a lot of the big companies are asking for more regulation and more legal frameworks to work within. And the Biden administration has been one of the two leading groups to actually propose late last year a framework for all of this. And then this is just as important. It's less about your legal obligations as a business owner, and it's much more about your ethical obligations. Do you want to just cut and paste text from ChatGPT? Do you want to eliminate jobs that ChatGPT doesn't require anymore? Do you want to invest in training your team so that they are AI enabled, which might make them more marketable with competitors? As Dr. Rachel Thomas said in her book, Data Ethics, and we'll give you a link to this book, which is the chapter in her book, which is excellent. There is no list of right answers. There is no list of do and don'ts. Ethics is complicated and context dependent. It involves the perspective of many stakeholders. It's a muscle that you have to develop and practice. So we're going to practice using the ethical muscle. We're going to ask, like, if it's possible, is it necessarily good and right and just? Just because we can do it, should we? So I wanted to welcome our first guest of many, Brett Spodak of Productive Power, who's going to talk about how ChatGPT amps productivity. Now, Brett is a productivity expert. He is someone who runs a company, helps train individuals and businesses in how to increase their efficiency and effectiveness. I am a client of Brett's. He's changed my life. I'll share something more with you later about that. Brett, thank you so much for joining us today and being our first guest for AI Marketing and Sales.
Dan, it's my pleasure. So glad to be a part of this amazing webinar series that you're putting on. I think it's so timely. I mean, you can tell by the number of people that are attending here how interested people are in the topic. I can't tell you how many people I've introduced to it, just personally and professionally. I mean, you can't help but be excited about it. It's kind of like when you first, played with the Google search engine or you first got your iPhone, and it was just so exciting to have this new tool that was so powerful, and you can't help but share it with people, because you're super excited about it and you just want to have other people see the potential and the power of it. And so that's really what's happening with us with ChatGPT. We call it the nickname Chat. Internally here, so we call it Chat, and we use it every day to amp up our marketing and to really accomplish whatever task we can think of more productively, more efficiently, and more effectively. So what I wanted to share with everyone today is a couple concepts that we have here at Productive Power, a couple frameworks that we operate within, and then I'm going to go in and show you how we specifically have applied ChatGPT to our workflows. And the output and the results that have happened as a product of that. So we're going to start with this framework. We call it the productivity, performance, and energy cycle. And it's really a framework that we realize existed in terms of, productivity really drives performance. There's a Bain study that showed that the most productive or the most high performing companies are 40% more productive than other companies. And so productivity really drives performance, and then performance in turn drives energy, and in turn drives more productivity. And so we have both a vicious cycle, which you had on the previous slide, and we have a virtuous cycle. So this can be either a positive or a negative feedback loop. So you might be in a situation where you don't have a particular good day, you don't perform well, you didn't have a good month in terms of revenue, or in terms of performance, and that kind of got you down, got you a little depressed and unmotivated. But as that turned, you're less efficient, you're a little distracted, you're not as productive, and that turns into lower performance, and the cycle continues. But what we strive to do is because we typically work with people that are really busy and never have enough time in the day, and they're overwhelmed and they're feeling that impact on their productivity and their performance. And what we do is we help turn it around by helping people become more productive. And that in turn drives greater performance, greater energy, and we get this positive feedback loop happening. We call that the virtuous cycle of productivity. And so the beauty is ChatGPT is like an adrenaline shot into your productivity, an adrenaline shot. And it really can have an incredible boost to your productivity, more than just about, as you mentioned, any piece of technology that I can remember. And I've been doing this for 30 years, And so if we want to really drill down and understand productivity, we also developed an equation called the productivity equation. And that's really the idea that efficiency times effectiveness equals productivity. And if you think about it, a lot of times when people talk about their performance, they say, oh, I'm really efficient, or I'm really effective, or I'm really productive. And those terms are oftentimes thrown interchangeably. But really, if you think about it, efficiency and effectiveness are factors that lead to the product of productivity in this equation. And so efficiency is really the amount of work done in a given amount of time, okay? So it's really the quantity of work you're able to do, and effectiveness is the quality of that work So you have efficiency, you have the speed, you have the quality, and in the end, you have the results and the productivity. And so what we found is with ChatGPT, like dramatically decreases the amount of time it takes to do something, right? So if anybody's been there, you put in a prompt and within seconds, you get back a result. It could have taken days, if not weeks, to get that kind of result back. And in terms of effectiveness, the quality of it, as Dan mentioned, you know, it's like having the world's, I'm going to go one step further and say the world's best copywriter at your fingertips, right? I mean, it really is an incredible researcher and producer of content. And so the results are 10 times better. So if you add those two together, you really get 100x and more. I mean, it's really unlimited in terms of the potential. I mean, we're producing things we would never, if we spent all the time in the world, have come up with the quality of work that we have as a result. And so I'm excited to show you a couple of these applications or the ways that we've used ChatGPT in our business. So I've got two use cases. The first use case, this is real. It's a workshop description. So we're attending an event and the folks that host the event said, we're going to open it up to all the vendors. If you want to do a presentation, put together a workshop description, and the conference attendees are going to vote on which workshops they want to attend. And the top two are going to get selected to be able to present at this conference. So we knew it would be competitive and we wanted to write something that was really compelling for our audience. And so our original kind of template or, you know, workshop description really targeted individuals, okay? And it read exactly as you see here, take control of your day. Do you never have enough time in the day? Are you overwhelmed with email? Do you worry about dropping the ball? Join productivity guru Brett Spodak and you can read the rest of it. And it describes the workshop that we put on. It's been very successful. I mean, we put that out and people want to know how they can become more productive. But in this case, we're targeting CIOs. And these are CIOs of big companies. And so we knew that if we went in with this approach, sure, we would get people that had this pain point. But what we really wanted to do is address the pain point of CIOs overall and in general, right? Because we want them coming with the mindset of, I want this to benefit my company. I want higher productive power to come in and help train our staff to be more productive. So we started with the prompt of, what do CIOs care about? What are their needs? What are they pertain to digital productivity? Things like that. And went back and forth. And this isn't a magic bullet. You know, this isn't like you put in a prompt, you get a result, you copy and paste and you're done. I mean, this is an iterative process. And oftentimes you'll find yourself spending even more time going back and forth that you might have spent without it, only because you're making progress. A lot of times when it comes to writing, if you don't make progress, you kind of get stuck and then you give up and then you move on. But with chat, because you're getting progress all along, continually getting better and better, it's very enticing to kind of keep moving and motivating to keep moving along with it. So at the end, we work back and forth. We end up with this amazing description, this title that came back, empowering the modern workforce with Microsoft 365. Unlock the secrets, gets them intrigued, learn how mastering, tells them what it's about, and then one final. And interweaved, we have, you know, terms like improve efficiency, collaboration, performance, ROI. These are all things that CIOs care about as it pertains to productivity. So what were the results? We got 72% of the people that actually selected our workshop. It was unbelievable, unbelievable. And so we've got selected to do the workshop and we're going to be doing it next month. And I'm excited to see what the results are going to be. So use case number two was another meeting we were attending. And in this case, we wanted to figure out a way to schedule meetings with people at the conference. So a lot of people in sales are going to conferences with the purpose of trying to generate business, to meet new people. And a lot of times people go to conferences in just hopes of meeting someone randomly that they might benefit from meeting. And what we find is it's much more productive if you take a very focused approach and intentional approach of trying to set up meetings before the event so that you actually go and meet with people at the event. And so in this particular event, they actually encourage that. They facilitate that for us. And so in the past, again, we're targeting, I didn't say this before, but we're targeting CHROs, so those human resource officers at companies. And in the past, we've sent out a generic message, like you see here. It tailored a little bit to the needs of an HRO, but it wasn't really highly personalized. Maybe the only thing personalized was about what human resource officers care about, but it was pretty successful. 15 out of 51, so 29% of the attendees last year had selected us to meet with them as it pertains to productivity. And so we put into chat, we work back and forth. And I have to say, I've had a lot of AI moments. This was one of them. I mean, I've had a lot of the first time you see it, you're like blown away, but then you continue to have these as you come up with these cool prompts that you can put in and get tremendous results. And so this prompt I just had to share because it just blew my mind the way it worked, but I'll share with you a prompt in a second. The end result is I got this paragraph. So what I wanted to do was lead this invite with a personalized message related to that company's mission statement, right? And so something like this: upon reviewing Amazon's website, its mission to this, I thought you might value, boom, boom, boom. These are all things HR people care about. And then to accomplish your objectives, right? And really make it more personal to that company's mission. So this was the result. We ended up getting 31 of 70 meetings this time. So 43% instead of 29 said that they would meet with us, which was a 50% increase in terms of percentage conversion. And how do we do it? This is the prompt you're going to want to use. So check this out. So we said, for each company in 40 words or less, complete this sentence. Upon reviewing this company's website and its mission too, again, this is exactly what we put in. And then afterwards we put colon and we put the names of 20 companies, and it literally did each company, boom, 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 boom. And we just copy and paste into an Excel, used Outlook to do an email merge, put it all together, and voila, we got the result. So
amazing.
Yeah, just love it.
Thank you, Brett. Thank you so much. In Monday's email, we're going to actually give you a link to a document with the actual text of his back and forth with ChatGPT and how he got to this. I just wanted to share a quick testimonial and then invite you guys all to an exciting opportunity. And Brett, if you want to put that URL into the chat, sure. Brett has agreed to give five free seats in his productivity class. I'm an alumnus of this class. I took it 2 years ago, and I literally took this screenshot this morning of my inbox. I call it inbox one. Brett taught me how to manage my tasks and manage my inbox. That is an actual screenshot from 7 a.m. of my inbox. And the only one I had was the guy from Microsoft AI that I've been chasing because he's going to be a guest for unit 4. And we just confirmed his participation this morning. So, you know, Brett, you've changed my life, man. Thank you. Thank you so much. And it's an incredible company. Having inbox zero is an incredible relief and weight off of our shoulders. So I welcome you to try it out, click on his chat and try to join his course. So that's it. We wanted to go and tell you what your homework is. I hope you feel inspired, challenged. You understand the tools, know the skills, and have the context. This is where we all bring it together. And your prompt is to pick one marketing or sales activity that ChatGPT could help with, and come back next week ready to give us that example. At the beginning of the session, we will invite you guys to give that to us. We're going to now wrap up. I just launched a poll. I'd love for you guys to share with us how we've done today and whether you found this valuable. First, I just want to remind us the journey we've been on together. First, we started with a live prompt. I can see that Nicole has been busily working away on some of them. We're going to actually schedule a bonus AMA to tackle some of the prompts. We're not going to have enough time for this first session. Nicole kept warning me, you're going to run out of time. You're going to run out of time. And Nicole, we ran out of time. We talked about the AI moment, that deeply human and emotional reaction to this artificial intelligence. A Google engineer had an AI moment where he claimed that Google's AI was sentient. He then got fired. But it's fooling everybody. And, you know, there's Wobot, which does therapy. There's incredible use cases of how there's Avatar Buddy, which does more positive reinforcement for young BIPOC children. There are incredible ways to use this tool for good and ill. And that is, all of us are having, I hope, our own AI moments. We talked about the history of AI, starting with the Turing test all the way up to the explosion that was ChatGPT 3.5, and the philosophy that we have of AI as a partner rather than a competitor or a nemesis or an adversary. the AI wars, Microsoft versus Google, US versus China, who's trying to be a leader in AI. We talked about the incredible battles that are being waged. And then we introduced your guides to navigating this world, Avatar Jeff, Nicole, and myself. We talked about five key definitions and five critical challenges that every business owner must keep in mind. And then we talked about how you can make yourself more productive and more effective in your work. Finally, we invited you guys to try to use some of these tools in your own business. We're going to give you more prompts and more opportunities to use your business with each week. And so what I wanted to ask was take a minute in the chat and share with us any ahas that you've had. What AI moments have you had? Yes, Nicole.
Can I share something just based on what we kind of promised
earlier? Yes, take 100%. Do it.
Okay. I need to be able to share the screen real quick. What I heard the most in there, so there's brochures, which we can get to because that's more visual. We'll get to that later. But everybody was saying they're spending time on social media posts. And what I did real quick, I took a bunch of keywords from some research that we did. Here's a list of keywords that I put into ChatGPT. I asked it to pick which keywords, based on prompts that people are putting into ChatGPT, would be the most valuable to do blog posts on. So then it gave me these questions, these 10 questions that are getting asked the most. Then I asked to rewrite those questions into captivating blog post titles. It rewrote them into these captivating blog post titles. And then I asked it to create social media posts for LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for each of the blog post titles using emojis and relevant hashtags. Now, if you had your blog post title or your topic you wanted to talk about, that's where you would start. So then it produced, it went through blog post by blog post, created a LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook post with emojis and hashtags. And this took me maybe 5 minutes, but now I have all of my blog post titles, my social media posts, and now I could spend another, I don't know, 5-10 minutes and create a blog post. I'd say to do all these 10, I could get it done in a couple hours now. And then we spend a little bit more time on the images and put them up. Like, it's so fast. And I wanted to show you how fast this can be, even if you just use this one thing, because a lot of people said social media posts. If you say create a social media post for Instagram about this, including these keywords, or including these hashtags, it'll do a nice one for you. If you've written one that you're like, oh, this isn't quite right, you can put it in here and ask it to rewrite it and make it funny, or rewrite it and make it powerful. You can have it rewrite to different tones of voice, or make it authoritative, or make it salesy, or make it informative, educational. You can change the kind of content you're putting out. You can have it rewrite your blog posts. It's just, it's so fast. I wanted to just take a couple minutes and show you that, so that hopefully between this session and the next one, you're going to save more time on doing your social media posting, and you'll come back with a smile on your face. That's it.
Bam. Drop the mic. You guys have no idea the tricks that Nicole has up her sleeves. Nicole, would it be okay for us to share the prompts that you used and the work that you did to get to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I can copy this all.
Yeah, we'll share that in the Monday email that you guys can expect from all of us. And so we just, we'll finish up the poll here and we'll wrap up momentarily. Thank you guys for the high ranking. 60% of you would like to attend an AMA, more than nearly 100 of you, where we kind of go and like just without so much structure, talk about some of these questions. We can think of it almost like office hours. We're more than happy to do it. We're going to be wrapping up here in a second, but I wanted to give you one parting thought, and this is a nod to my grandpa, who was a physics professor, and also to BizHack's mission to make growing your business simpler. Albert Einstein said, make everything as simple as possible, but not simpler. And that's our commitment to you. Over the course of the next 7 sessions, our next 10 hours together, we are going to do everything in our power to cut through the noise and simplify these tools so that you can use them in your life, in your business, and to stay ahead of this incredible wave that we're all living through. This is one of the most exciting moments in the history of humanity and the history of technology. And we're going to go in open-eyed with the risks and the opportunities fully in front of us. Thank you guys for joining us today. Please spread the word. We had nearly 300 people today. We'd like to make that 3,000. So help us spread the word. And we look forward to seeing you in 1 week from today for AI, for text, translation, and email. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you,
Nicole. Thank you, Brett. Thank you, Danilo. Mike and John, you've been working behind the scenes tirelessly. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dan.
Great job.
It was great.
Great job. Thank you.
All right. We'll see you in a week, everybody.